There definitely are major differences between how business is run now between they were in the 1980s. My MBA program, I remember the purpose of the organization is to maximize shareholder value. That was the academic, and it stuck in my head for a very long time. And it seems like that's shifting significantly because the internal customer, the employees, are wanting something different. The conscious organizations are developing. And so I hear what you're saying is that you're responding to your customer both externally and internally, because if you don't, then there's going to be a mismatch. You're going to have turnover and disengagement and all those things are going to happen. And that engagement factor is so important, because one of the things I know you write about is the idea of employee emotional exhaustion. Can you talk a little bit about, you know, what causes employee emotional exhaustion and what can really be done about it?
Yeah, and especially right now, that's an important topic, right? Mm-hmm. We got so much going on, and the work environment is super challenging because of COVID, that there's arguably more emotional exhaustion going on. And what that is, so emotional exhaustion actually was part of the burnout literature, and it is one of the burnout dimensions, but it became almost like the most important one. I say that in quotations. In that it became the focus. When people think about burnout, they think about emotional exhaustion. And that's when you only have the capacity to manage and think about and do so much from an emotional processing perspective until you're just depleted, right? It's this sense of emotional depletion. And so where does that come from? Well, anytime you're embedded in an environment, you almost can think of it as like a bucket where you can only handle so much water, and a little bit more gets put in, a little bit more gets put in, a little bit more gets put in until you reach that threshold where you just can't hold anymore. And then when that happens, because of all the things going on in your environment, it's too much, then you start to withdraw and you start to feel this lack of energy and this lack of vigor. And that is when emotional exhaustion is manifesting for that individual. And so what can managers actually do about it to try and prevent that or mitigate it once it actually does take place? There's a variety of different models, but this fits within the stress literature really well. And I think the number one maybe simple approach is to think about it in terms of demand, control, and support. The demand, control, support model would say, number one, you need to try and reduce the demands on that individual, because clearly they can't handle all the stuff that's going on. And maybe that's a matter of pushing away tasks. Maybe that's a matter of helping them reprioritize. And then also giving them more control is the second aspect. So give them the autonomy, give them the discretion to figure things out in ways that are suitable for them. So as managers, our instinct is to try and help by kind of parsing it out for people, but instead give them the bandwidth to say, no, you can, as long as you accomplish XYZ objective, do it however you see fit. So give them more control. And then the third one is support. And that support can be in the form of emotional support, just helping them cope and think through things. Or it can be more structural type support, giving them more time, giving them more resources, whether it be through some type of system or software or an assistant or something along those lines. So when you start to see signals of emotional exhaustion, reduce demand, increase control, increase support.
What are some of those signals that managers encounter that gives the manager feedback? Hey, they're on that burnout spectrum. They're getting to the threshold of that bucket.
Right. You know what's interesting about that is a lot of times those signals are subtle, and and a lot of times they're nonverbal. And so big challenge is that when you only see somebody, maybe you see your subordinate, for example, once a day on a 20-minute Zoom, your window of opportunity to see those has shortened. And as well, the richness of communication, because it's virtual or because it's just a phone call, is minimized. And so it's becoming harder and harder to see those signals than what it was before. And you'll start to see those, whether it's through comments or whether it's through just a lack of energy or lack of interest. But I would encourage managers, at least in these scenarios in particular, to push and ask. And when they say everything's fine, to ask again. And if they're still not opening up or admitting what their challenges are, no matter how severe or minor they are, another option is to start exposing your own challenges, because employees tend to role model the behaviors of their leaders. So there's what's called social learning theory that would suggest that we are more likely to look up to, role model those in hierarchical positions, because that signals the types of behaviors that we should be engaging in order to move up. Because if they are in a hierarchical position, then that's what you should be doing. And so if you do it yourself, admitting and talking through some of your challenges, they might be more likely to do it as well.